Let us start this lecture with a thought process that lack of love lures lacunas in the lake of life. Whatever lacunas we find in ourselves is because of we don't have a power to love others and also ourselves. So that is, let us now get into the thermodynamics. In the last lecture, we discuss about the psychometry kind of things, and there we looked at the properties, how to handle the weight mixtures, and it can be useful for the air conditioning, and we have seen various applications how you can use the relationship and also psychometric charts. Psychometric chart is very useful to do the calculation very quickly and have a visualization of the process very easily, And today we will be looking at basically the thermodynamic relations. And if you look at why do we want to look at thermodynamic relations, we have looked at various relationship till now, but why will be looking at this? Because there are several relationship we have learnt, pertaining to the first law of thermodynamics, second law of thermodynamics, and if you look at Gibbs relationship, all those things we have looked at, several of them. But now we'll devote devoting around two lectures on this, but question arises, why? Remember that when we discuss about the thermodynamic properties, right, we looked at several properties, and then also use those properties for evaluating the various thermodynamic terms, for evaluating the work done or the change in enthalpy, change in entropy, and other things, right? And all these properties are very important for the analyzing the problem and arriving at some quantitative data to appreciate what is happening. But however, most of the properties, if you look at are not really measurable, right? There are several properties which
cannot be measured. For example, entropy, enthalpy,
internal energy. If you look at those things, we do use. And if you look at, we take a very simple, a single phase pure substance, that there will be several properties. You make a question, how many properties are used, for describing or analyzing a single phase pure substance. So there are several of them. If you look at 8 properties that can be used, let's say pressure, volume, temperature. So if you look at, these are all measurable properties. One can measure. We can, use also entropy, internal energy, enthalpy, and the Gibbs, function, and A is basically the Helmer's function, right? This, if you look at, the 3 properties are measurable and rest are unmeasurable properties. If it is a complex system, there will be several more properties will be coming into pictures, right? And now we need to express these non-measurable properties in terms of the measurable properties. Then only we can, relate these things and find out the properties data, and then that can be utilized. So as I told, this, measurable properties, is it only the pressure, volume, temperature? Or some other measurable properties are there, Any idea? You know, if you look at specific heat, right? Isothermal compressibility, coefficient of volume expansion, these are all can be measured. It can be, you know, they can be considered as a measurable property because you can measure them, right? But we are considering this three of them here. And these, however, the what you call something five properties I have just mentioned for a single phase pure substance, and that has to be expressed in terms of three properties which are measurable, right? So question arises, what are the ways of relating, you know, the measurable properties and non-measurable properties? That is the basis for which we will be studying the thermodynamic relations, right? So if you look at, let us consider pressure is a quantities. Pressure is a function of x and y, right? Let's say, and I can write down that as change in pressure is equal to dou p by dou x when y constant into dx plus dou p by dou y x constant into dy. This you know very well, you know, from the calculus. So if I divide this equation by dx, right, and keeping the z constant, right, if I divide this by dx here, right, and keeping the z constant, I will get dou p by dou x z, because this will be 1, right, and dou p by dou x when z remain constant is equal to dou p by dou x when y remaining constant plus dou p by dou y when x remaining constant into dou y by dou x when z is remaining constant. So if you look at these are kind of things what will be using to have a relationship. Now we will go back to the properties, like the measurable properties are basically three for a single phase pure substance, and the non-measurable properties are is five, total is eight. If I look at the permutation of this between eight and three, that means number of partial derivative one can do is basically 336. It's a big number, that many relationship one can think of, right? And if I look at this relationship here, then there are total basically out of 336 relationship, if we can express here, it is a total 4. And if I take a permutation of that, total number of possible thermodynamic relation will be around 5.2 into 10 power to 8. It is a big number, It's very difficult for a human being to remember that. Are you getting? This many relationship one can think of just taking 8 properties, start with. But if it is more, then it will be much more. Are you getting my point? That is, basically, it is very difficult to handle so many relationships which can come up. Of course, all of them you may not use it for your analysis, but however it can. So therefore, we should know how to handle those things, and we'll be learning about that, and we'll be using two methods. One is partial differentiation or partial derivative method, other is Jacobian methods. I guess all of you know these methods. Only thing what we'll do, we'll have to recapitulate the salient features of this and use it to deriving various thermodynamic relationships, right? So let us look at first the partial derivative method. And if you recall, there are basically three rules are there, right, of partial derivative methods. So what are those? Can anybody tell me? Because you know this thing, you have done the courses, right? Let me give you a clue, like chain rule, cyclic rule, right? Reciprocal rule, all those things you know, right? So let us recapitulate what it can be. Let us consider a relation between three variables, x, y, z kind of things, right? And we can say that function which is like a x, y, z, and then I can write down z is basically function of x, y. Then I can write down from this, the change in z is equal to dou z by dou x when y remaining constant into dx plus dou z by dou y, x remaining constant into dy. And similarly, I can take ax is a function of z and y. I can write down similarly change in the x, right, whatever it is, and do that. And I can have any function and write down in the similar form. Now, if you look at the reciprocal relation, will be basically dou x by dou y, z remaining constant is equal to dou y by dou x, z remaining constant. This I think you know, you just recapitulate and keep it in mind, right? I am not going to derive these things, right? And the cyclic relationship, if you look at it, is basically dou x by dou y, z remaining constant into dou y by dou z, x remaining constant into dou z by dou x, y remaining constant is equal to minus 1, right? And if I say that that z is a function of a p and y, where p is a function of x, then I can write down cyclic relationship, and considering that y remaining constant, it's not changing, right? So by that, I can write down the chain rule as dou z by dou x, y remaining constant is equal to dou z by dou p, and y remaining constant for all the case into dou p by dou x. This is basically chain rule, kind of thing. So we'll be using these three relationship for deriving or simplifying the various relationship, thermodynamic relationship. And let us take an example, how we can use that and what is the usefulness. So if you look at an ideal gas in a piston cylinder at 300 Kelvin and 0.9 meter cube per kg undergoes a process by which its temperature and specific volume are changed by 2 Kelvin and 0.04 meter cube per kg respectively, right? And determine the change in the pressure of this gas. So how we are going to do that? So if you look at that, what are the given? So dT is given, that is 2 Kelvin, and specific volume is a change in specific volume is given 0.04 meter cube per kg. And of course, ideal gas is given, so you can use the ideal gas law for this. And the volume, specific volume is given as 0.9 meter cube per kg. And the temperature is also given, right, 300 Kelvin. So to find basically change in pressure, right? So if you look at ideal gas law is given, so therefore I can use ideal gas law PV is equal to RT, right? And if you look at P is basically function of what? P is function of T and V. So I can write down from this dP is equal to dou P by dou T into V into dT plus dou P by dou V T into dV, right? So if I know this relationship, what it will be then? This will be basically dou P by dou T. So this will be R by V into dt. Yes or no? Dou P by dou T when volume remaining constant, so that will be R by V dt. Plus dou P by dou V when temperature is remaining constant, it will be minus, right, na? And that will be basically dou P by dou V. So therefore, it will be V square minus 1 by V square into R T dV. Right. If I take this R over outside, I can say this dT by V minus R T R won't be there, T into V square. So I will substitute these values. That will be R. R is, what is the R value? We can take 0.287 into dT is 2 Kelvin, right? And V is 0.9 minus T is, T will be 300 Kelvin, right? And dV is basically 0.04 into V square is 0.9 whole square, right? You will get something around 3.19 kilopascal, right? So if you look at, I mean, that way you can find out change in the pressure, right, kind of things. So we will now see how we can basically derive this, what you call thermodynamic relationship. But before that, we will see the Jacobian methods, right, how it can be applied in thermodynamics. So, the partial, what you call derivative, can be easily manipulated by the Jacobian methods. So, if I say that x is a function of Pr and y is a function of Pr, then the Jacobian of xy with respect to Pr can be defined as, you know, like is equal to basically dou x by dou p and dou x by dou r and dou y by dou p and dou y by dou r. So it is a matrix format, and that is the, and you can do this cross multiplication. For example, that will be dou x by dou p into dou y by dou r, this term, right, minus dou y by dou p into dou x by dou r. So if you look at that, you can express in this form the Jacobians, which is quite, you know, looks to be little complex, but however it will be very useful, like when we handle that. And Jacobians obeys the following property. The way we have looked at, you know, the properties for partial derivatives, similar way we can also have properties for the Jacobians. So that is, one is Jacobian xy with respect to Pr into Jacobian Pr with respect to St is nothing but Jacobian xy with respect to St. And dou x by dou y when z is remaining constant can be written as the Jacobian xz with respect to yz, right? And so you can get from here very easily from this. For example, like if I say this is, you know, like xz, like kind of thing. So I can write down from here what it would be? Xz, if I say this is xz by yz, right? So that will be dou x by dou y into dou z by dou z minus, if you look at this is dou z by dou y into dou x by dou z. So if you look at this is basically 0, right? So and this is 1, so you will get basically x Jacobian xz with respect to yz is nothing but your dou x by dou y when z is remaining constant. So you can very easily get this one, you know, this is the term which will be remaining. So very easily you can get. Similarly, if you look at Jacobian xy with respect to any arbitrary will be equal to the Jacobian yx, that means just opposite, you know, like kind of thing, you can change the another property. You can do also, you can say the Jacobian xy with respect to pr is equal to minus Jacobian yx with respect to pr, that is the meaning. And the another interesting, the Jacobian xy with respect to pr is equal to 0. I mean, you can put this here in this expression and do that yourself, right? For example, if you want to this thing, I can show you that this Jacobian xx, Jacobian xx with respect to pr will be equal to dou x by dou p into dou x by dou x minus dou x by dou p into dou x by dou x. So if you look at this is 1, this is 1, so therefore this equal to 0, right? You can get very easily. These are the things you can verify by using that relationship. So if I say that you know, z is a function of x, y, and z is a thermodynamic property, and it can be, you know, it can be a property thermodynamic only when it is exact. Like that we have you know, learned in the very beginning, and from the then I can write down dz is equal to dou z by dou x when y remaining constant into dx plus dou z by dou y x remaining constant into dy. So I can write down this thing in terms of Jacobians, like this is a differential form, right? And this is a Jacobian form. I can write down dou z by dou x by using this second relationship, like by using this relationship, I can write down very easily here, right? Dou z by dou x is nothing but Jacobian z y with respect to x y. And similarly, dou z by dou y when x remaining constant, we can write down the Jacobian z x with respect to y x. It's a very easy to convert that, you know, partial derivative to the Jacobians. And equation 1, this you can write down as a dz is equal to m dx plus n dy, because we want to, you know, consider see that whether it is a property or not. And for that, it should be exact. So therefore, what we'll have to do? We'll have to basically put these conditions, you know, like kind of things. That is basically dou m by dou y when x is constant equal to dou n by dou x when x is constant, that we have seen. So keep in mind that m is basically Jacobian z y with respect to x y, and whereas n is Jacobian z x with respect to y x. So, and if we'll divide this equation by dA, right? So I can write down that dou z by dou A when B, you know, is constant. We are keeping the B constant is equal to dou z by dou x when y remaining constant into dou x by dou A when be remaining constant plus dou z by dou y when x is remaining constant into dou y by dou a when b remaining constant. So this you can write down in the Jacobian form, right, which are very easily, which we have seen that by using the Jacobian rule you can write down in the Jacobian form. So in that, what you can do, you can write down in a very simple expression. How? Because what you will do, you can multiply it here, what you call, let's say I will multiply it by here, that x y Jacobian, right? And if I multiply by this, then if you look at all our remaining constant. But now what we will do, we will have to see that x, y, a, b, and here also if I want to, then I can say this as a minus, I can say this is x, this is z, and here it is minus. And similarly, I can also put it here minus and write down in place of this y in place of z. So I can take all these things to the from the right hand side to the left hand side, I can write down very easily this expression, right? Because this is same as that, you know, x, it will go to left hand side, it became positive. So you can write down, which is a very simple expression kind of things in the Jacobian form. So if you look at this, can be written as the, you know, this equation 2 can be written as the in forms of M I have introduced, where M is the Jacobian ZY with respect to XY and N is Jacobian ZX with respect to YX. Then we can write down this, basically the Jacobian ZB is equal to M Jacobian XB plus N Jacobian YB. And if you look at, we know this Gibbs equation, that is du is equal to tds minus pdv, right? If you observe this equation, basically it is the change in internal energy dependent on the entropy and also the specific volume. I can write down u is a function of s and v, right? So if you look at, if I want this to be a property, right, we can do that. But similarly, we have seen also the Gibbs second equation, dH is equal to TdS plus VdP. This we have already derived earlier, right? And applying this, you know, above property of the Jacobian to Gibbs relationship, we can write down as U, Jacobian Ux is equal to T into Jacobian Sx minus P Jacobian Vx, right? We can take x is arbitrary, we are taking variables, and similar way we can write down also for enthalpy, right? So if you look at, by this we can, we'll be using basically how to handle the Jacobian, how we will convert the partial derivative into Jacobians. And now we will be looking at you know, thermodynamic potentials. So question is, what do you mean by potential? Potential always, you know, basically to ability to do work, you know, is basically tell you that what is the potential to work, and what are the properties we can think of that as an ability to do the work. Any idea? So if you recall that the first law of thermodynamics, we looked at it, right? What it is doing. If you look at even the objective of the classical thermodynamics is to convert the microscopic form of energy into macroscopic form. So when you talk about this macroscopic form of energy, we use basically internal energy, right? And internal energy is having ability to do the work, and that is the first law of thermodynamics derived from there, right? Okay, rather the internal energy is defined in the first law of thermodynamics, right? It's a property of the system. So, if you, as a matter of fact, the most natural, you know, like thermodynamic potential is the internal energy, which is, but the rest of the things are derived from that. And the thermodynamic properties are internal energy, enthalpy, Helmholtz potential, and Gibbs potential. Of course, there is a grand potential, which we will not be discussing about it, right? But we'll be discussing about these four potentials only. That is, that will be basically tell us the ability to do the work. So these potentials of the system, which cannot be measured directly, because these are the properties I have already told earlier, that you cannot measure directly. You can measure pressure, volume, temperature, or specific heat, you know, isothermal compressibilities and others, but you cannot measure. And whereas for simple compressible substance, you know, like we need these kind of things, potentials to be utilized. And we are having three properties, pressure, volume, temperature, that can be measured directly. That means we need to express this thing in terms of what you call the properties that is measurable. And as I told that, for a pure substance in a single phase, a thermodynamic potential has to be expressed, you know, in terms of two other properties. We have already seen that, right? So, as I told, the internal energy is basically a one of the thermodynamic potential. And let us consider a system undergoes a change during an adiabatic process. You can think of our simple piston cylinder arrangement, you know, like kind of things. Let's say it is having some gas, right? And this is our system. So it is, you know, at a very high pressure, let's say P1. T1 and ambient pressure is P0 kind of thing, and P1 is greater than P0. So then when it will release this piston, then piston will move, right? There will be expansion. So there is some work being done, right? And of course, if we are saying adiabatic, then what will happen to the change in internal energy? Change in internal energy, right, will be basically the work done, right? So we can apply the first law of thermodynamics, that is equal to du minus dw, because as is the adiabatic process, dq is equal to zero. So therefore, that clearly says, you know, that the internal energy is a thermodynamic potential, because the change in internal energy is reflected in the change in work. So, work is done due to the change in internal energy and vice versa. So, therefore, that U is known as the thermodynamic potential. And from the first law, of course, we know that dU is equal to dQ minus dW. And from second law, we know that dQ by T is equal to dS. So therefore, I can write down as dq is equal to tds, and if I can use this here, you know, tds here, I will get a relationship, right, that is du is equal to tds minus pdv, right? And this is, we are saying pdv work. Work can be other thing, but we are saying this is pdv work, right? Dw is basically pdv, right? So this is the Gibbs first equation, what we have earlier derived, and this we can derive again, I mean, like, and that clearly say, indicates that the internal energy is basically a thermodynamic potential. And let us look at enthalpy. Like let us consider a turbine, right, which is a flow work one can think of, and we can apply the first law of thermodynamics for a control volume of a turbine, right, and we can apply the basically the first law of thermodynamics for a control volume system. Of course, this is a whole equation, and we can assume it's a steady flow process, so therefore this will be zero. And change in kinetic energy, you know, is zero, and change in potential energy also zero, we are considering for the simplicity. And from the mass conservation, I can write down m dot I is equal to m dot E is equal to m dot for a steady flow process. So therefore, the equation, you know, can be written as shaft work is equal to minus HE minus HI, and keep in mind that we are considering this as an adiabatic process also, right? This is a zero adiabatic process. So therefore, we are considering change in you know, enthalpy is nothing but your shaft work, right? That indicates that enthalpy is basically thermodynamic potential. But of course, we know that H is equal to U plus PV, and therefore we can differentiate it. That is, dH is equal to dU plus PdV plus VdP. And already we know the Gibbs first equation, that is equal to dU is equal to TdS minus PdV. So therefore, I can write down this as TdS minus PdV plus PdV plus VdP, and this cancel it out. So that comes to be basically dH is equal to TdS plus VdP. And this is your Gibbs second equation, which we will be using this, you know, Gibbs first equation, second equation, and very, you know, very much. And we will be looking at that. And let us look at Helmer's free energy. Of course, what we will be doing, generally people use Helmer's potential as Helmer's free energy, but we will be discussing about that and what are the differences. For that, let us consider a system interacting with its surrounding, right? And we can apply the first law of thermodynamics to find out work done by a system during a given process, right? And that is equal to dW is equal to dQ minus dU, right? And let the surrounding be maintained at a constant temperature T naught, right? Ambient temperature, and which is not affected by you know, interaction with that. So, because it's a very thermal reservoir, you can say, and if you, we can apply the second law of thermodynamics, that is change in, you know, entropy. This is for the system, right? If you look at this, is corresponding to the system, right? Plus the change in entropy corresponding to the surrounding. That is plus dS naught is will be greater than equal to zero, right? And what will be the change in what you call entropy? Because let's say there is a you know, system, like for example, we can take this piston and cylinder arrangement kind of thing, same thing, whatever you have seen just now, right? This is my system. And this is gas at T1 and P1, and the surrounding is T naught, right? And it will be expanded. I mean, like, you know, it can go, when it will be released, piston can move up and it can be expanded. So then what will happen? Like there will be some heat can enter into here, you know, from the surrounding, if you allow. So that is nothing but dQ. So if you look at the heat is entering into the system, right? And that means heat is coming from the surrounding to the system. So therefore, the sign will be negative in this case. So dS naught, change in entropy for the surrounding, will be minus dQ divided by T naught. T naught is the ambient temperature or the surrounding temperature. Then if I put this thing here, you know, in this equation, that is dS minus dQ divided by T naught will be greater than or equal to 0, right? And therefore, we can write down this as basically dQ will be less than or equal to T naught dS. And what we will do, we will use this thing in the equation, this equation 1 I can say, and this is equation 2, right? I can use this expression for dQ from equation 2 to the equation 1, and when you do that, I will get the work done, you know, as basically less than or equal to T dS minus dU, right? This we will know, and that I can write down as, because you know, like work done will be less than U1 minus U2, let us say from state 1 to state 2, minus T naught S1 minus S2, right? One can think of writing 1, 2 basically, right? And then I can say that if it is T1 is equal to T2 is T naught, we can write down that very easily as the work done between the, what you call, state 1 to 2 is basically U1 minus T1 S1 minus U2 minus T2 S2. And this term is nothing but your A1, that is Helmer's function. This is known as Helmer's function, right? This term was basically function or potential, you can write, right? And similarly, this portion also, right? That is A2. And this change in Helmer's potential or the function is known as the Helmer's free energy. So if you look at the total, this portion is known as free energy. Of course, in the some book people do use interchangeably, right? But whenever we talk about free energy, the change in the Helmer's potential, right? So and the Helmer's potential, as I told, U minus TS, that is the Helmer's potential, I told. So therefore, I can write down this as dA is equal to dU minus TdS minus SdT. I'm just differentiate this, you know, and I can do that. And but whereas the dU is equal to TdS minus PdV. So if I can write down here TdS minus TdS, right? Minus PdV minus SdT. So this will cancel it out, right? This will cancel it out. So therefore, I will be getting the dA is equal to minus SdT minus PdV, right? So this is again the similar to what we have derived for the internal energy and enthalpy, and this is of course the Gibbs, this is of course the Helmer's free energy. And in the similar manner, we are going to also derive the, what you call, the Gibbs free energy, that is the change in Gibbs function or the potential. So let us consider a system which is operating under steady state flow through a control volume. You can think of about a turbine kind of things, you know, like you can think of a turbine, right? Which is, you know, flow is coming, flow is going out. Of course, this is having a shaft, you know, kind of things. This is a turbine. So we can apply the first law of thermodynamics for a steady flow process. So therefore, these will be equal to 0, and change in kinetic energy will be 0, and change in potential energy 0, kind of things. And of course we know this mass flow rate, like a steady flow process, therefore m dot I is equal to m dot E is equal to m dot, and you can divide this equation by this mass flow rate and you will get an expression as what you call W sapped is equal to Q minus H E minus H I. So this is from the first law of thermodynamics, and this work done is per unit mass, so also the change in enthalpy, so also the heat interaction per unit mass, all are per unit mass. So if the control volume receives heat energy from the surrounding T naught, then we can write down change in entropy is equal to minus Q divided by T naught, right? That we have already seen for the control mass system. And we know from the second law of thermodynamics, change in entropy for the system plus the change in entropy for the surrounding, its surrounding greater than equal to 0. So we can write down then delta S minus Q by T naught greater than equal to 0. So therefore, Q is less than T naught into delta S, in this case basically AC minus SI, right? This we have already derived similar expression for. So when you combine this equation 1 and equation 2, then we can write down the SAPT work is basically less than T naught into change in entropy between the exit and the inlet minus the change in enthalpy between the exit and the inlet, right? So therefore, we can also make this thing that T I is equal to T E is equal to T naught. We can say that the SAPT work will be less than H I minus T I S I minus, of course there is another, this is the same thing, like change in enthalpy and then T E into S E, and this we call it as a Gibbs function or the potential, right? And that is G is basically H minus T S. Keep in mind that this Gibbs function is being very much used for the chemical systems kind of things. And this change in the Gibbs, Gibbs function, this portion we can call it as a basically Gibbs free energy, right? And G is a Gibbs potential. That is the only difference, and because it says that the potential are having to do the work. And we can derive, we can differentiate this Gibbs function, and dg is equal to dh minus tds minus sdt, and we know this Gibbs second equation, dh is equal to ts plus bdp, and we can write down that as equal to tds plus vdp minus tds minus sdt. So this will be cancel it out. So I can get expression as dg is equal to vdp minus sdt. So if you look at this four expression like this, we have derived, one is for internal energy change, other is for the enthalpy change, and we have also derived for the Helmholtz function and or the potential and Gibbs function, right? And all are, if you look at, some of them are function of, entropy and specific volume, and some of them also function of pressure and temperature, like the Gibbs free energy change. So I can write down here also G is a function of basically P and T. So we will be using this expression for relating this measurable properties with the unmeasurable or non-measurable properties, right? That we'll be doing in the next class, and for that we'll be deriving some relationship, right? And we'll be using that. So thank you very much for your kind attention.